All right, we have more changes unfolding in the U.S. economy and in the household sector for the U.S. consumer. Changes that have investors no longer buying the Fed's plan, completely discounting what they say and doing the complete opposite. If you didn't see what just happened this past week and what the markets did following Jerome Powell's interview on Friday, well, you'll see in a minute because it's important if you're looking to buy a house, sell a house, or if you're in any way concerned about a loan that you have or need to obtain, you're going to want to pay attention because a lot changed this week. The zeitgeist of this period just shifted and things are getting ready to change. So we're going to cover what just happened. We'll listen to what Jerome Powell said on Friday, why it matters, how badly it affected markets, and what the market's now expecting to happen in just 1 month from today, just one more month. But before we get started, press the like button and consider subscribing. It helps me out, and I appreciate your support. So the Fed, folks, the Fed pivot, actually, the pivot that the media and most investors have been waiting for, dreaming for these past 20 months, may be right around the corner, but not for the reason that most people expect. This past week concluded November's market melt-up, where we saw the S&P rise 9%, the NASDAQ up 11%, pretty much everything ended the week up. In fact, it was the best November the U.S. stock market has seen since 1980. Take a look at this. You know that we prefer to look at flows instead of technicals. Well, here's what we saw this week. High yield bonds saw their largest four-week inflow since June 2020, $12 billion. U.S. growth stocks saw its largest inflow in 11 weeks. Financials, which is very interesting, saw the largest inflow since August of last year. Two of the most underbought sectors just came soaring back this week. High yield bonds and financials, both of which spent the last year getting crushed, which means one thing, risk on. The market now firmly believes a Fed pivot is right around the corner, and just like 1 week, betting odds for the first Fed rate cut shifted significantly. Take a look at this. The market's now priced in a 90% chance of a March 2024 rate cut and a 10% chance of a January 24 rate cut. Last week, January wasn't even in the cards, folks. January is in 1 month, one freaking month. March is in 3 months. 60 days ago, things looked completely different. So what happened? What changed that could account for such a drastic shift? Well, financial media is going to tell you it's got to do with inflation falling, that the Fed has all but won, and inflation's now almost back to 2%. But the real story is that economic pain has reached its final stage, the consumer. Something you see happen toward the end of a Fed tightening campaign. First, it hits the banks or the finance sector, which it already did. We saw that happening all year, starting back in March during the banking crisis. Then after banks comes the business sector. And lastly, it spills over to the consumer, which makes sense, right? As banks get squeezed, they stop lending, causing businesses to stop growing, which forced them to stop hiring. Then they stop dishing out bonuses, they stop pay raises, and they start laying people off. And finally, that trickles out into consumer-related data, which we're starting to see. Last week, we looked at 401k hardship withdrawals jumping 300% in 2023, which only happens when you're in trouble and you need cash fast. By the way, if you want access to this research database, go to our website. It's in the description of the video. And there's more consumer bad news data. Since October, bad consumer data has begun rolling in. I can show you dozens of different data points, but most importantly is banks' willingness to lend to consumers has been deteriorating in the last few quarters. They spell it out clearly in the last Sluice report. Banks specifically mentioned how they are unlikely to write new loans for borrowers with FICO scores of 680 or less. Take a look at this. This is the summary of the October Sluice from the Fed's website. It says this: questions on consumer lending. Over the third quarter, significant net shares of banks reported tightening lending standards for credit card and other consumer loans, while a moderate net share of banks reported tighter standards for auto loans as well. It's why interest rates on your credit cards are so damn high, over 25% APR. Rates on auto loans as well, now over 8%. And higher interest rates have led to higher delinquencies. Auto delinquencies spiking, auto loans transitioning to serious delinquency, which means more than 90 days past due, back to 08 levels. Likewise, serious delinquencies on credit cards spiking as well. And remember how student loan payments resumed this past September, a few months ago. Well, that additional $400 to $500 a month payment appears to have done the trick as consumer spending slowed down after they restarted. And this is from the BLS's personal consumption expenditures data, PCE, something that the Fed loves to look at, which brings us to the elephant in the room, right? What did Jerome Powell, the chair of the Federal Reserve, say this past Friday that sent the market into a buying frenzy? Risk assets shot up across the board. Even Bitcoin and Ether saw large inflows following this interview. Well, let's take a listen.
The high inflation that we got beginning in 21 initially emerged from a collision between very strong demand and pandemic-constrained supply. And the normalization of supply and demand conditions that we've seen has played a critical role in the disinflation, the coming down of inflation so far, as has the substantial tightening of monetary policy and overall financial conditions over the past 2 years. The strong actions that we've taken have moved our policy rate up and well into restrictive territory, by which we mean that tight monetary policy is putting downward pressure on economic activity and inflation.
Now, that small segment of his speech on Friday is all the market heard, confirming monetary policy is well into restrictive territory and now weighing down economic activity, signaling future rate hikes are off the table, as in economic activity is already being weighed down, so there's no more need for rate hikes. The market reads that as the Fed is done. Now, is that the case? I have no idea. There's no way, you know, to know for sure what the Fed's going to do. It's not without precedent, though, that they do hike again after a long pause. But what I can say for sure is that most investment banks have changed their rate cut projections. Almost all of them, with the exception of Goldman Sachs, now forecast the first rate cut happens in early 2024. Multiple banks, multiple big banks, now forecast rapid and large rate cuts in 2024 as recession starts. We have UBS and ING both now saying that a hard landing will force them to start cutting in March. UBS says expect 275 basis points of rate cuts next year, and ING says 150 basis points. That's a lot. Additionally, like we looked at early in the video, the market now has it at 90% odds that the first rate cut happens in March. What I will say is that there's this growing body of evidence that the consumer is in trouble, and the fact that the lags from their rate hikes haven't fully been felt yet. For example, corporate loans are now starting to roll over. With that comes layoffs, lots and lots of layoffs. Realize these loans are high yield loans, or high yield bonds rather. The corporations who borrowed this money aren't investment grade companies. They're large companies who are financially vulnerable. And once the cost to service their debt jumps by 300, 400, maybe even up to 600 basis points when these loans roll over, they'll have no choice but to go into survival mode and start laying people off. So yeah, it's likely the Fed is done hiking. And as the data continues to weaken, we're going to start to see them cut rates. We're getting closer, all right? That's for sure. All right, that wraps up the news portion of today's video. Now I want to tell you about today's sponsor, which is tied directly to the race for AI dominance in the healthcare space. That company is called HealWell AI Inc., an AI healthcare technology company focused on artificial intelligence for preventative care, the type of AI software that the medical community is just now beginning to use in hopes of saving lives through early identification and detection of disease. If you're tied into the AI space at all, you already know how big of a market this is expected to be, the like healthcare AI market, the possible implications of this space, what it could do for healthcare, for preventative care and early diagnosis, but even more so for the cost of healthcare. And right now, it's in the early stage, folks. The market right now is just being noticed. As of 2022, it was a $19 billion a year industry, estimated to grow to $281 billion by 2032. And why is that? Because if AI could solve or help with late or misdiagnosis, it would be a game changer. You could see the mortality rate on like early diagnosis versus late diagnosis here. It's why the medical community is so eager to see what can come from this space. And HealWell AI is directly linked to this effort. They're focused on becoming a healthcare AI powerhouse, and they're in a very unique position to do that. So what exactly do they do? Well, their AI products, their technology is used by healthcare providers to screen and detect 110 plus different diseases. Early disease detection and screening is a huge opportunity in the health space, but they're also a capital management, like M&A company focused on capital management to try and consolidate, find some of the best healthcare AI softwares, companies and products out there, small companies with promising products that can make a huge difference in this space in the future. And they acquire them, or they acquire like an ownership stake in the company. They're currently trading at 98 cents a share with a market cap of $88 million Canadian. The stock's like been ripping higher though lately. Back in July, it was only around 20 cents a share. And guess who their lead investor is? Guess who's now backing them? Well Health Technologies, a massive healthcare company. In fact, it's Canada's largest healthcare provider network, close to a $1 billion company, Well Health is, and they just entered into a strategic partnership with HealWell AI, closing a multi-million dollar deal to help them continue what they're doing. And that's why this is so unique, why HealWell AI is now in such a unique position. We all know that like AI in general is like only as good as its data, right? Without access to data, the AI is just useless. Well, that's the beauty of this deal, because it's not just the capital that HealWell raised, but also all the other perks that come along with it, like the data from Canada's largest healthcare provider network. Just to make this clear, their lead investor, Well Health, has deep pockets, folks, and knows what they're doing. They're also the largest operator of outpatient health clinics in all of Canada. So together, HealWell has the AI tools and Well Health has the data from their massive healthcare provider network. It's a great idea, right? And along with that, another part of this deal is that they've basically become Well's capital allocation vehicle for preventative health and like finding these like AI targets now. And like I said at the beginning of the video, they're aiming to become this healthcare AI powerhouse. And with the backing of Well Health, they're in a position to succeed. Now, I'm not saying that that's definitely going to happen, but that's their goal. That's their plan, and they're already executing on it. For example, last month, they announced plans to acquire control of Pentavere, another healthcare artificial intelligence company whose product Darwin is like known in the industry as best in class, already validated by some of the largest pharmaceutical companies in the world, and whose research into this space has been published by some of the most prestigious publications globally. Well, they acquired controlling interest in that company. From what I understand, they're looking for more acquisition targets. They're planning to continue to grow this capital management side of the business to keep finding and acquiring these best-in-class healthcare AI products. Basically, imagine if a company 5 years ago knew what would happen to ChatGPT, you know, and they come along and they acquire controlling interest in it when it's still in its infancy or in early stages. Well, today, ChatGPT has a valuation that would make your head explode. Well, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to find the best-in-class products and companies, identify them early, and bring them under their umbrella. So once again, companies called HealWell AI. I put a link to their website in the description of the video in case you want to learn more about them. I'm just giving you an overview of the company, an overview of the industry. That's all. They're public, so all the information is available. Do your own due diligence, and I'll see you in the next one.